Welcome back to VOR Classic with Joel, Mike, and Ed.
You were,
you were talking about Grievous.
General Grievous!
In regards to Grievous, I sort of trailed off. However, I think what I was saying was that Grievous was different, and they tried to fit him into that, into the Star Wars, the whole universe.
Uh-huh.
But he was different, and that's why it was so difficult. This universe that has so many base characters, characters that are very, very primary.
Yeah.
Your primary bad guy and your good guy, all of that's been established. Fitting a Grievous in is difficult. I think he did, but because they weren't tearing off or using some other character and just kind of reworking them. Like, mm-hmm. Hey, Lando Calrissian works. Let's make a bad Lando.
So you're saying he's more original.
Because he's more original, he didn't seem to fit right off the bat.
Well, perhaps. I mean, for me, it was mostly about the aesthetics, not the character. Because the character I love the concept of Grievous. But it's just like the visual impact of this super high tech, like seemingly more advanced cyborg than anything we've seen.
Yeah.
In the future of when Grievous is supposed to exist, that's what really got to me.
When Vader and 2-1-B, the medical droid, like represent the typical like kind of, well, even 2-1-B is like one of those things of where it's just kind of only the fans have said, you know, like, who knows what the original.
Oh, that, but, is he supposed to be a cyborg?
Yeah, that he has like
what?
I know, but it's one of those that anyway. when Vader, and looking at Vader and 2-1-B exist
the future.
Exist as the only cyborgs that we know from the original trilogy.
Yeah.
Mm.
You know, except for like maybe some of the stuff that's in Jabba's palace or whatever, you know, like a Bomar monk or something.
Yeah.
You know, like the big spider thing that was like down the hall from in Jabba's palace. Yeah, when you've got those type of things, yeah, Grievous seems like extremely, extremely advanced. You know, and so like, you know, like a rationalist will say, well, that's because the CIS orchestrations of the banking clan, Muffalatos. I don't know what Muffalato means, but you know, like that they're that they created it, and that technology's gone whenever droids were supposedly outlawed. So they've got their escape clause.
Yeah,
but still, yeah, I've already bitched about this before, but like Corey. Like our friend, our old roommate, had mentioned to me that he had seen a picture going around. Mm-hmm. And if you have the Star Wars Visionaries comic,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
It has the story of that Darth Maul got some cyber pants. Mm-hmm. They just took the top half of Darth Maul, kind of, you know, sutured him up, and he had like these like cybernetic legs, which look a lot like Grievous's legs.
Mm-hmm.
And so even though I mentioned on this podcast before, I just want to reiterate, how fucking cool would it have been if Obi-Wan comes up against him at the end, and whenever you have that scene of where they're looking at each other's eyes, you know, and the camera gets in, which is so like non-Star Warsian in terms of like, you know, right. Like editing and like, you know, the camera cuts. And
yeah,
getting really close to the eyes.
Right. That scene was stood out because, you know,
it was,
Lucas has always taken the quote unquote documentary approach to this whole thing.
Yeah, always like establishing shots and mid camera shots.
Right.
So would it not have fucking rocked if they come in on Grievous's eyes and like suddenly Obi-Wan realize, oh shit, it's that guy.
Right.
You know,
and you see that like you can even keep the tattoo and the weird Sith eyes, the crazy Sith eyes of Maul.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I mean like that would have like totally like brought it home, you know? Because like one of the big things, and unfortunately you were talking about this at dinner, that and again with the hand gestures, like that no one at home can see.
Well, now they know.
And like I'm looking like Dr. Gory over here. So or Mojo Jojo, you will listen to me and listen to me good. We shouldn't have to rely on the books and comics and all this other stuff to fill in the gaps. I mean, like,
right.
You know, really the movie should provide everything,
right?
And then like I don't know, like have you read the Revenge of the Sith yet, Mike?
No, not yet.
The thing
I'm still waiting for y'all to float that in my direction.
Oh, okay, sorry.
You gotta float me some books back. And then I'll start putting books out again.
Okay, absolutely. I guess that.
No, I'm not trying to slap you down. I'm just telling you.
Just the one, right?
I think it's just the one.
Okay,
but
right on. You'll have it.
So, it's got signatures and stuff in it.
So here's like the cool thing. Like the Visionaries thing also got into the story of like how this general or whatever was picked or whatever, you know, to become General Grievous, and like he was in a shuttle crash or something. What's really neat about it, and the way that the book handled it. And the way that, like, if they had just shown this in the movie, it would have, like, explained so much. And the way that that they like did it is that no matter what, they've been fighting the battle droids for like, and the banking clans and, mm-hmm. you know, the Confederacy. They've been fighting them for X number of years.
Mm-hmm.
Well, suddenly, out of nowhere, there's a leader. One that they've no one's ever heard of this guy, and he shows up, and whenever he shows up, there's a massacre. There's a bloodbath.
Right. And supposedly, he shows up. He supposedly makes his debut at Geonosis.
Yeah, supposedly he was at Geonosis, like, having his army, like, built. That was his, like, his initial push.
Yeah.
Was that they were supposed to be, like, building the armies on Geonosis, and he was going to be taken off from there. But basically, even that kind of goes against what the thing, what the basic story behind, about Grievous, that Grievous, I think it was Kalish or something. I don't know what race he was or whatever. That but basically, right. he was like the Stalin, the Saddam Hussein of his people. That there was a huge civil war.
Yeah.
And
well, there was two people sharing a planet that were constantly at war with each other, and he was coming out the leader. But then the other team actually made a deal with like slavers or mercenaries or something. I think it was like slavers. To say that if you help us fight them, you know, if you help us put them down, then we will like hook you up with this and this and this and this. So then they got involved, and then they were like enslaving and murdering the Kalish. And he was like, yeah, he had to go like guerrilla style in order to try and fight these guys. And they were slaughtering him, and they were enslaving his people. So, there was like nothing he can do. And that's when he was contacted by the separatists, or Dooku or someone, and, you know, because they knew that he was like, before these other guys got involved, these more technologically advanced guys got involved, he was, well, I'm having my EU minute.
Yeah.
He was the shit. I mean, he was brilliant and he was unstoppable. But he's doing it for his people. So they made him a deal where like, oh, well, we could help your people if you would just do this and this. And he's like, look, I don't need your outsider help. Okay. Outsider help is what's, you know, screwing us over here. So I'm going to do it my way. Oh, then he has a shuttle crash and almost dies. But who's there to rescue him? Dooku. So then Dooku makes him another deal. It's like, I will save you and I will save your people and we will wipe these people out. We will wipe out these invaders if you come work for me. So what do you say? And of course, he's like, of course, save my people. I'll do whatever you want. And that was it. And he gave himself over and then he became, you know, Dooku's project and came out as a... the Grievous we know.
Well, let me ask you this really quickly, just in regards to the aesthetic.
Yeah.
He wasn't humanoid before.
Yeah, he was humanoid before.
Yeah, he was humanoid.
Yeah. Humanoid, but he was an alien. He was like an alien type thing.
Yeah.
But, okay. So he woke up one day and he had this freaky body.
Yeah. Yeah. But here's the one.
Yeah,
here's the one thing,
like some of his, obviously his guts and his head and his brain and spine and stuff. But.
Here's the one thing that you didn't touch on is that he's highly xenophobic. And could give one rat fuck about anybody that's not his people.
Okay.
Yeah, that's
he
what...
He could give one crap. That's the reason that he didn't want anything to do with Dooku. He didn't want anything to do with these other people. And the way that he, like, won over his planet or whatever was by, like, slaughtering all of them.
Okay.
You know, like and so that's why I mentioned the Hussein. He doesn't mind, you know, like, killing any one of his people, too.
To get to somebody, yeah.
Yeah, and so...
Yeah,
so basically,
all at the ends.
The awesome thing about the book is that that they're trying to throw the Republic off. So the battle droids and the army will just attack anywhere. Well, Grievous is not in charge of them. He just shows up at the end and kills as many people as he can, leaves enough people alive that see him to get the story started, and then mm-hmm. he takes off. He just does the cameo at the end Paris Hilton. You know, like, he just kind of...
That's so we don't... Reese Witherspoon.
He's the... Peace, Heather Poon. When it comes to, I guess, what do you call the stupid newspaper? The Holonet. I don't want to be that gay.
Well,
the Holonet.
The
Holonet.
On there, in the Star Wars.
In the Star Wars universe, like their term of newspaper.
It's the Holonet.
Whatever. So all they know, and all the people back home see, is that whenever this Grievous guy shows up on a planet, everyone's dead.
Right.
You know, and so he shows up at the end. He's squirrely. He doesn't give one shit.
Mm-hmm.
And like, he will abandon his ship at the first, you know, at the first thought of there being any sort of, damage to him, and then he moves on to the next battleground. They're all planned, and all he has to do is just show up at the end, kill as many people as possible, make sure that someone can pass on the story so you don't kill everybody.
Right.
And then he just moves on to the next project, and he laughs about it the whole time.
He's just he's a violent rock star.
Yeah.
He comes in, he rocks you, and he splits.
Yeah, Kraven, like if it looks like that he will not survive, he'll take off immediately.
Oh, yeah.
He won't hang out.
Right. Okay.
You know, like if you know, and they kind of touch on that in the movie that, you know, like Obi-Wan's like, oh, well, you want to fight me? And he takes off immediately.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, it's not his deal. It's not his fight. He doesn't give one shit. He just shows up, picks a fight, and takes off.
Right.
So, one of my favorite scenes in the book was that he's on his ship, the Invisible Hand.
Right.
The Invisible Hand. And so they're pretty much getting broadsided by, like, the Republic guys, and they're blowing it all up. And I think I've talked about this like so many times to you guys like off the air, but it's kind of the funny thing that you've got all these like Nemoidians and all these battle droids and all these people like on the bridge, and so like
there were more Nemoidians in the book than there were in the movie because this scene is so violent in the book.
Yeah.
So anyway.
Yeah. So like so Grievous is there, and like all of them know that he's kind of a figurehead, but as long as he's around, he'll just kill you.
Yeah.
And so, like, they're all sitting there, and they're like, well, we've all heard the stories. If you say anything against this guy, he's just going to kill you. He doesn't give a shit. You know? And he'll either, like, have a droid on this station or whatever. You might as well just do your job. So they're getting broadsided, and they're, like, totally getting blown the fuck up. But you see, that's not important. He just needs to hang out long enough for the Jedi to get on board.
Yeah.
He doesn't give a shit how. Mm-hmm. So they're blowing the fuck out of his ship. And so they're going, well, sir, we need to redirect, and we need to shut off some of these guns, and we need to redirect our energy into like putting up the shields. He goes, nope, just keep firing. Right. And like they're going, well, we're not going to survive another salvo, and
we're going to lose life support.
We're going to lose life support. We're going to lose all this stuff. And he just kind of looks at him, and he just keeps going, yeah, keep firing. But if we keep firing, the guns are going to overheat, and they're going to explode themselves, and we're not going to have anything. And he's like, keep firing.
And then that guy's head gets destroyed, and then someone else gets a promotion, very Vader style.
Really,
like, keep firing.
But yeah, it's one of those deals of where he's just buying time. He doesn't give a crap because he's out. And then it's the slow realization of everybody in that crew chamber. Everybody that's working there is just like, fuck, we're not making it out of here. He's gonna dip in just a minute.
Yep.
You know, we're not gonna make it out of here. He totally has done this before.
Yeah. Unlike Vader, where like you may get killed if you screw up. If you get assigned to Grievous, it's almost like guaranteed that you're gonna die.
Yeah, he's not hanging out. He's not gonna be around.
Yeah. So anyway.
To continue this episode of VOR Classic, click the link on your screen now. Right now! If you like it, please click the thumb and share it with your friend. Now, let's continue the episode.